please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Taking Stock, the show where we take stock of the week gone by on the street and, of course, tell you all about the important triggers, the news and the cues, and prepare you for what's coming up next. Well, if for the market needed a flying start, that's exactly what it got in the first week of 2018. We've closed off pretty much at fresh all-time highs on the Nifty, the Nifty Bank surging away as well. And of course, the mid-cap party, you know, we spent quite a bit of time trying to figure that out because, yes, the mid-cap index continues to be on its own upward trajectory as well. With me is Nimesha again. I think the bulls couldn't have asked for a better start to the year. Right? It's like the party is just continuing.
Oh, yes. In fact, it's about global markets. The entire Asia is up 4%. The mature markets are up 2-3%. So it's basically bulls across the globe having a party, you know, starting in 2018. And I think that's becoming more India as well. Look at their five floors at the beginning of this year. Yeah. It's been positive. So looks like, at least for the timing, the party is on, so enjoy. In fact, you're going to have some of the best experts to tell us. So let's take it forward from them.
To the Edelweiss House to get their perspective on this mega bull run that seems to be underway. We have both Vikas, Khemani as well as Aditya, Narain with us. Thank you gentlemen so much for taking out the time. Season's greetings, wishes of the new year to both of you. Aditya, I'll ask you the simplest question we've been asking everybody. Whether this year can continue the kind of victory that last year set off. There's a fair amount of caution when you speak to fund managers as well. What's your view?
I think it can continue the momentum it is showing. The returns should actually be pretty decent. Will they replicate last year's 27-28%? Maybe that's expecting too much. But in terms of the basic momentum, I think there should be no letup.
Okay. Vikas?
Again, pretty much similar, but the way I see 2018, it'll be a year of micro improvements and a bit of macro challenges. We will start seeing corporate earnings pick up as we progress into the year. No doubt about it. We will start seeing capex picking up, start seeing numbers improving across the board. We will have to worry about some of the global macro level, worry about local macro as they're panning out, whether it's interest rates going up or kind of liquidity constraint might have as we move forward, given the fiscal challenges we have ahead of us. Also, I think the way global situations are panning out, you might see a little bit of, as Fed reduces the balance sheet and increases the interest rate, you might see dollar strengthening and having some implications for the emerging market. So the combination of all these things, I feel that probably this year would be, improving micros, worrying some macros, but having said that, it will still deliver good returns. It may not be as smooth as we had in 2017. 2017 was the calmest year, one way, and more importantly, least volatile. We have not seen this kind of volatility regime for decades, and globally, not only in India. So this kind of calmness in markets are kind of unsustainable according to me. So I think one other feature one should keep in mind this year, it will be a lot more volatile than 2017, apart from the returns, and volatility is one has to keep in mind.
Okay. So because if you're expecting volatility, where it will come from? Will it be domestic triggers? Or do you think this volatility will largely cause from global markets, whether it's a nuclear war, whether it's more than expected rate hike by the Fed? What to your mind could cause this volatility for the markets in 2018?
You cannot never predict what will the volatility or correction will come from. All you can think is one of three or four factors which can kind of lead to this. So as I said, global macros are slightly worrisome. If US dollar starts strengthening and the US kind of downsizing the balance sheet, you might see emerging market currencies weakening, and thereby cost and availability of money towards emerging market might be a challenge. I mean, this year, last year, all emerging markets did very well. India was no exception. We were kind of pretty much part of the global party. So it is really wrong to say globally things change, India won't get impacted. It will get impacted. Second point is that I think we are sitting on reasonably high amount of leverage locally. And the outstanding position in the futures and options, outstanding position in the loan against shares is close to almost $30 billion. Now, when you have this kind of position outstanding, everybody on the same side of the market, anything changing small, we saw a small glimpse of that on the Gujarat of results there, right? So anything can happen, can have an impact on the market significantly. So in my opinion, you know, it could come out from various issues, fiscal deficit. Right now, there are some challenges expected. So if interest rate starts going up, oil continues to, let's say, remain strong, you might have challenges on our inflation rate. So I think, you know, it's a combination of a lot of factors, geopolitical. Nobody can, in my opinion, predict what will happen. So I think, you know, it can come from any side, but definitely it looks like that we will have some sort of volatility introduced by the, you know, macro factors.
You know, but if I could just stick to the positives right now, and first 1 week, auto sales data, particularly CV sales, that PMI number, which, you know, went to a 5-year high, some of these data points, and some of the corporates that we've been speaking to, whether it's CV financiers, you know, companies, post-consumer companies, that the commentary is very, very bullish. So, something really turning on the earnings front, and then...
I think it's a combination of elements. One, obviously, there's some data support because you've got a base effect, but I think that's, you know, well and truly flagged. The other bit is, I thought you saw too much despondency last time around, right through the year, when earnings were not coming through or numbers were effectively not hard or very supportive. There is, at the end of the day, for all cycles, there is a timing element. And, you know, if people want to time it within a quarter or within 2 quarters, it's very, very difficult. What you're effectively seeing is, you had a multi-year slowdown. You had a fair amount of corporate refix that's happened. You had an interest rate structure, the latest move notwithstanding, having come down quite a bit. And right through this, you had consumer optimism reasonably sustained. So there comes a point when that starts effectively turning around. And I think the hard work has actually been done in this economy for a fairly extensive period of time. So I think, you know, our sense is that obviously you're going to get that base effect. You will get much better earnings. But I think the vibrancy on the demand side is, I think, what could effectively surprise the market a little bit.
That's exactly what I wanted to ask, whether this turn is already priced in, because that's what 2017 was all about, right? Chasing the elusive earnings recovery, or whether the market can now build from here when it's actually seeing the hard number.
The thing is that if you look at last year, and, you know, our call then was that valuations will stay high as you wait for cyclical numbers to start coming through. Once you see those numbers starting to come through, we are not saying that valuations will go further, but then the bulk of your returns will start coming from valuations, and particularly from any sets of upgrades that you actually start seeing, because hard numbers are baked in,
but the moment you start seeing some level of upgrades, I think it's going to be a very different story. What you've got to remember is, even though while we've had a, you know, a earnings cut down cycle by and large, the reality is earnings are cut much more aggressively when they are weak. And the moment you start seeing the nose go up, you start seeing the upgrade cycle, or at least much more positivism to it. So I think that is the swing that you're seeing, whether this quarter is going to be inflection or is going to be next, so it's hard to call, but there are signs that it could well be this quarter.
Aditya, I know you track financials very closely for many years. I'll ask you about financials, but before that, I was looking at your 2018 outlook note, and surprisingly, you've given, you know, some contra which you're going to bet on, the likes of IT, pharma, and to some extent telecom services as well. Your thought process on why you're liking these contra bets?
So I think IT very clearly, you know, and before that, I'll just make a comment on earnings. I think earnings also will start with broad-based, you know. So far, we had a lot of distressed sector pulling down the earnings growth. They are now going to contribute to the sort of growth. So I think that will be a great part of, you know, earnings growth. But coming to the IT, I think so, I think it comes from the fact that I see a little bit of global macro challenge, which will have an implication on the emerging market currency depreciating. Secondly, I think if you see, US growth is coming, it has been very, very solid. And the US tax rate cut, the discretionary model sort of spend will go up in US corporates. And based on our interaction with IT, we are hearing a lot of body language, positive comments, you know, in private, you know, that we are sensing that. So it looks like that, you know, the sector after long is coming back. Sector after long, you know, could deliver good. It is an unknown sector. It is a natural hedge against your currency. And plus, you know,
where a lot of companies are sitting on cash.
So buyback will be there to provide support to the downside. And, you know, if developed markets surprise you, you would have. So I would say, you know, one must have some sort of good exposure to IT sector. Similarly, I think pharma, I think, has been for quite some time. Again, currency impact would be there, but for some time it has been in out of flavor. By and large, we think that, you know, regulatory issues are behind. Whether it will bottom out in the next 2 months, 6 months, we don't know, but valuations are in your favor. So I think it could provide a good contra hedge. Similarly, telecom, I think consolidation has happened. By and large, I think most of the negative issues are behind. From here, the pricing will start improving, volumes will start improving, and which will be good for overall shareholder return. I think geo impact, by and large, the destructive impact is over. Now I think probably there's some sort of
sanity. The way today, IDS went up by 10%. Anyway, since the beginning of last year, Bharat is going to be outperforming. So looks like that probably quantum is playing out. Aditya, to you on financials, because that's something you've been tracking for so long now. Usually, overweight sector, it's one of the biggest in terms of weightages within the index. Your call, still bullish?
We remain bullish. One, it is a kind of a decadal theme, right? And there's nothing to disrupt that from a near-term perspective. Secondly, as we talked about the whole consumption cycle, I think that effectively plays through that. So the businesses that have done very well will actually continue to run on that. Thirdly, there is a great evolution that we are talking about, whether it is housing, a certain amount of infrastructure that will provide you a certain amount of momentum. And the fourth, which is a little variable in terms of timing, is going to be the whole asset recovery cycle. Now, in our view, the asset recovery cycle is upon us. It's a question of the pricing and the, where those haircuts happen vis-a-vis expectations, which are effectively, which remain relatively hard to call. But the peak of the cycle has happened. You're going to get into a recovery cycle, and I think that provides you a certain amount of payment. I think the other thing that you must remember is that, you know, what are the risks, the risks tend to be from a macro perspective, rates tending to go up. Now, to some extent, you've actually already experienced a little bit of that, in terms of the secondary market, and some level it has taken some sheen off some of these stocks. So I think that also factors in some of the risks that potentially lie in a sector that's run hard. But otherwise, we stay, pretty bullish on this broader space.
So quickly to, sum up the financials, please. What would be the pecking order then? If you're looking at NBFCs, would you stick to, let's say, consumer finance plays? Would you look at, housing finance? Is MFI, paying interest rate right now?
Comfort would be with the private sector banks at this point in time. Simply because, as I said, there is some element of interest rate risk in terms of them having reversed. There is a macro call that Vikas talked about where there are certain uncertainties. There is the election element. So, when these come in, then businesses with higher valuations and higher implicit growth expectations, those could be a little bit more vulnerable.
Well, gentlemen, do stay right here because we need to take a quick break. We are going to come back on the other side. The conversation continues as we take the break. Here are some more market opinions that we picked up during the course of 2 weeks.
I think, given the kind of market levels and valuations at about 18 times a year forward and more on the mid-cap, a little bit more on the mid-cap side, I think we would be a lot more conservative in terms of return expectations for the next 12 months. The PE or the valuation re-rating, I think, is kind of broadly done with at this point in time. We would tend to believe that the returns that one makes into the next 12 to 15 months would be a lot more driven by earnings growth in different parts of the market.
The statistics are that we have 2 or 3 months every year where the correction is more than 6 to 8% in a month. This happened even in 2016 three times, in Jan, Feb and November. It happened in 2015, I think, 2 times. This year it did not happen, that is in 2017. It must be coming without any reason, without any great logic. And then we don't want that, at least in the beginning of the year.
I think the consumer durable space has got a lot more expensive. I think 2017 was incredible for them from a valuation point of view. It's one of the best performing sectors. So one should be a bit careful right now. But two opportunities which look extremely attractive in the consumer space. One is, of course, this whole travel and hospitality space. And outside of airlines, but you should really look at some of these companies which are into the holiday side, the forex side. I think that's a space which is extremely good. Core hospitality, companies which run resorts. I think that's a very, very exciting space. Growth opportunity is phenomenal out there. So that's one. And two is, I think, on the consumer side again, food as a business, I think, is a fantastic opportunity.
And I don't think this year will be able to match last year's sort of returns. And also the nature of the movement will also be slightly different. It's about time earnings growth picks up in terms of contributing to stock price returns. over the multiple expansion. In fact, you could see some sort of compression in multiples, or at best, stability in multiples. So it's about time the recovery in the economy that we're seeing now also trickles down into corporate profitability improving. And finally, we see some sort of a double-digit or even a 15% sort of earnings growth to the index level.
A great start to 2018, and the question is this going to continue pretty much throughout this year? So, let me ask you about one theme that the year kind of began with. Everybody was trying to pick the next Reliance Communications, the next JP Associates, the whole play the stressed assets game in the mid-cap market. Aditya, your thoughts on this, and I'm not getting company-specific, but there's also a big debate raging whether there's any merit in buying these shares right now or not, whether equity value will go to zero, whether you can play for a flip, because there's no denying that some of the companies do have great underlying assets.
I think at this point in time, people are believing more in businesses rather than necessarily trades. Okay. Secondly, because it's had a checkered past over the last 6 months in terms of what asset values are, how the process of the whole NCLT actually plays, people are going to be a little watchful on that, at least for the initial ones. I think the next stage is when you actually get up some, you actually have some resolutions where either asset values are much lower than expected or much higher, then you're going to see a little bit of a pattern and you see a fair amount of playing that actually tends to happen. But in the early stage, I think people are still looking for multi-baggers rather than 30% pops. And I think that, and given the uncertainty that you had over a period of time, I think that's going to be a middle of the year kind of trade rather than a trade in the early part of the year.
A related question, and that will bring me to the next theme as well. Because we were talking about real estate stocks, and I believe that you would rather buy real estate stocks than real estate. One such company that suddenly had a change of sentiment overnight was, of course, the Realty, and we all know why. Your view on this whole, play the turnaround or fund on the turnaround, as well as, of course, real estate, and why you would still buy the stocks.
Like real estate structurally changing with the implementation. I think the game has changed, for good. Earlier the game was real estate developers were buy land, hold it for some time, more you delay, more you make money. Now it has changed to more you sell, more you make money. So you got to have credibility with the land sellers, you got to have credibility with the financial, you got to have credibility with the customers. So I think people who have good track record of delivering with to the customer and to the ecosystem will do well. All other players will get out of the business. To that extent, it is a very good situation for the industry. I think the new regulations will deal with the corruption and all related. I think there will be a lot more transparency in the sector. I think this is very good. I give an analogy, and this is very similar to what happened to capital markets after the formation of SEBI. SEBI got formed in 1992, and I think what we saw in the last 20-25 years, it's in front of us. I think the real estate sector is much bigger than the capital market, and it can be a lot, widespread and meaningful. So I think this is that stage. So hence I said that you will get many multi-baggers in this sector over the next 5-10 years. Obviously, you've got to choose your sector, the right stock, right? As far as I think resistance is concerned, you need to do your work. I don't think one should really depend on, retail investors cannot do that. You can't rely on the hearsay, you will get duped. It is a work, deep work, it requires deep work to understand the asset value, what kind of cuts will happen. So I would advise somebody to dabble into it.
Because the other sector which probably you look at as a decadal kind of theme is a big shift from anonymous to organized, and a lot of sectors are going to win from that. Just your thoughts on which other sectors that you would be betting on as a big theme, as a move from anonymous to organized.
So I think given whatever reforms we have had in the last one and a half years in this government, I think they are setting up for moving lots of sectors from unorganized to organized, and also as the per capita income goes up, technological need, consumer demand will also push that shift to organized players, because the normal players or unorganized players will not be able to keep up with the pace of change in the demand and advancement in the demand. So to that extent, I think it is happening. It will cut across many sectors, actually. Obviously, it will cut across. Let us say it will cut across building materials, tile. We have already seen huge amount of thing happening. It is in some sense also touching in financials. So financial is what? The original lenders moving towards microfinance to the small finance bank is also an unorganized organized move. So I think today India, as India is being reset, this unorganized organized theme actually cuts across many sectors, even chemicals. As the environmental norms are getting tighter and tighter, marginal players are getting out, and you are going towards large-scale capacities, global capacities.
This shift story or more of a China story? Because likes of graphite and all have become like 5x, 6x, 10x stocks in the last 1 year.
So the entire chemical sector would never hardly have an investment in the last 10 to 15, 20 years. And because of dumping from China, when that has stopped, local businesses started to become viable, which is also propelling this, and local environmental issues have become tight. So with that, a lot more investment now can go into this sector. And lots of companies are putting in global scale capacity, and this is something very important. So I do believe that large scale capacities make in India, all those things is now coming to life. And over the next 5 to 10 years, we will see a widespread growth happening in this.
Just 30 seconds left on the show, so let me get your final thoughts. Can this market keep going higher at current oil prices, or if oil reaches 70? Any other caveats you'd like to put out?
Let me put it this way. I think the higher oil goes, the more of a pushback it is. And if it obviously goes up dramatically, then it's one of the macro risks that we refer to. Right? So that will be a little bit of a showstopper. But oil staying here or coming off a little bit, I don't think it's going to stop the market from generally tending to move up. I think because I like the fact that there will be volatility, and this is going to be one of those prime drivers of volatility. But by and large, I think directionally, I think you're okay. And when you have the tailwind of valuation, of earnings, and the macro reset that has happened in the economy over the last 3-4 years, I think the runway will be, the runway is out there ahead for the market.
Any index targets for us that you'd like to put out there? What percentage gain?
I actually look at mid-teen returns for the year.
The Nifty today broke out of 10,550 and the Bank Nifty broke out of 25,550, 600. Both should make further gains from here. I think Nifty can head up to 10,750, similarly Bank Nifty can head up to 26,000. In terms of stocks specific, yes, Bank broke out from a consolidation, it's bottomed out from lowest 200 EMA, that's a buy stop of 328 out of 350. Similarly, RBL Bank has broken out, that's a buy stop of 537 target of 560. And Reliance Infra has restarted its uptrend, that's a buy stop of 575 target of 600.